And actually, in 2011, I went to Australia with Bob Barker and pretty much spent the next 6 years not really leaving it. I pretty much gave up everything to be on that ship. I started as, well, actually, I used to work as an academic liaison librarian at the University of Sheffield. So I had like no idea what it was like being at sea. I had no idea what it was like on a ship. I had really no idea about anything. Like I used to do a bit of diving. If anybody went to the talk before mine, I volunteered for the Marine Megafauna Foundation in Mozambique before I actually joined. So that was really kind of my only experience in conservation as well. But what I did, I went over and I joined as a deckhand and pretty much learned everything that I know now on board the ship. And I went from being a deckhand, I learned how to weld. So when I went back to Sheffield, I took a welding course, ended up going back as a welder for about 18 months. Then I got various different boat licenses. I actually went to the States to study and became a captain. So it is one of these things where you can kind of learn on the job as well. A lot of people ask me, but I can't do anything. Neither could I. I could not do a thing. I'd never picked a power tool up. And there I was as a ship's welder for like 18 months on there. So honestly, if I can do it, anybody can do this. So what I really wanted to do was protect these guys. I know today's all about sharks. I am going to get to sharks. But I think it's important for people to know how Sea Shepherd got more into doing things with sharks. And we started with these whale defense campaigns. And it was the big thing for me. I wanted to save whales. That's why I joined Sea Shepherd. It was all about whales. But as you kind of do these campaigns and you see more and more of the biodiversity in our oceans, you start to care about all the other animals that are there as well. So during this time, Japanese whale poachers were actually targeting 1,035 whales every year in a marine sanctuary. So they were targeting 935 minke whales, 50 of these humpback whales, and 50 fin whales as well, despite the moratorium on commercial whaling. So we did a number of campaigns. This was probably our most successful. Has anybody seen this picture before? Okay. Normally, I am not used to a screen this massive because I would actually point to where I am in this. And if you see, so on the big ship that says research, that's the Nushin Maru, that's the factory whaling ship. So it's where they do all the chopping up of the meat, the processing and all the storage. This is the Bob Barker in the middle, and you can see just at the end of the ship, there's like a tiny little boat with a bit of orange on it. That was where I was during that time. And it's become probably the most successful whale defense campaign that Sea Shepherd had. It was Operation Zero Tolerance, and during that we saved 932 whales. And one of the reasons why we were so successful in doing that is because we kept doing this. The red ship on the right is the refueling tanker. So what we were essentially doing was shutting off the fuel line for the factory fleet, for the factory ship that was trying to take on more fuel. You can see that there's a lot of red, which means it's high in the water. If it was full of fuel, it'd be a lot lower and you wouldn't see that red. So we were basically trying to stop them from refueling because it meant that they'd get to a certain point and they'd have to go home. And they did. They actually ended the campaign, it was in February. And normally they're just kind of all the way through into mid-March, late March, April sometimes if they haven't killed enough. So we send them home, and this is where it gets graphic, I'm sorry. And that is basically one of the main photos that we got from that to show people exactly what's happening. In a marine sanctuary, this is Antarctica, it's a pristine ocean. There are very few areas of the world that are still looking like that now. So to show people the brutality of these operations was key for our successes to get funding, to get more ships, to get more volunteers, to be more successful with our campaigns. Now, I wanted to talk a little bit about the whaling campaign specifically because in 2014 we were given a unique opportunity and that the International Court of Justice at this point ruled that their whaling program was illegal, which is what we've been saying for years. Somebody now, with some authority, was finally saying that this research program is illegal. So what the Japanese whaling fleet then went and did was decided to go on a hiatus, and we were like, great, we don't have to go to Antarctica this year. But we did, actually. We ended up going to protect these really ugly know what that is. That is a Patagonia toothfish. And again, these are, they're very unique in that they have like a really oily flesh, so they're very difficult to overcook, with cod stocks being decimated throughout the world. People started to go more and more for toothfish. It's called Chilean sea bass, if you ever see it on a menu. And for the most part, they're fished illegally as well. And when we wanted to go off and try and protect Patagonia and Antarctic toothfish, we found that there were six vessels operating in what we call the shadow lands of Antarctica. One of those ships is this one. Has anybody seen that picture before? So this is the fishing vessel Thunder. And it was quite a naive plan that we had. We knew that there were six vessels operating in the area. We knew they were all operating illegally. And all we wanted to do was find one of them. We just wanted to find one of them. We wanted to follow it, and we wanted to report on it. So this vessel has what is known as a purple notice from Interpol, and it was a vessel of interest to Interpol. So we kind of felt like we struck gold. And what we did, we followed it for 110 days. It's become the world record for the longest maritime pursuit at sea, and it was an endurance, a test of endurance, that's for sure. But after 110 days, we woke up one morning to an action station's alarm. So I come running out of the ship, and I'm like, what's going on? And everyone's like, the ship's sinking. I'm like, kidding me? What? And yeah, so what had happened, the owners of the vessel had actually told the captain to scuttle his own vessel. And the point of that was they wanted to get rid of all of the evidence that was basically on board to show that they'd been illegally fishing for years and years and years and years and years. So during this pursuit, we actually ended up working in collaboration with a lot of governments along West Africa. Now, I know most people probably know what Africa looks like, but if I was to say, does anybody know where Gabon is? You'd probably look at me a bit crazy, because it's not really a country that you hear much about. But it's actually, you can see that, right, the bomb just at the bottom. And they were the only government, when we were in touch with them, that said they would arrest this vessel if it came into their territorial waters. They were the only ones willing to act. And what that meant is, for us, we were able to develop this relationship and go back to Gabon with a vessel and help them to start patrolling their own waters. A lot of these countries don't have the ability to do that. They have a coast guard, or they have marines, they have people that are supposed to patrol the waters, but they don't have a ship that can go out to do it for them, like take them basically to the areas that they need to be. So when we went back, we ended up taking on the Marine National. We took on six armed guards as well as four fisheries observers. And the point of the campaign was to patrol their kind of 200 limit, their 200 mile limit. So we could see if there was any illegal fishing, unregulated fishing, or unreported fishing. And for the most part, what we found are these guys. To give you a bit of perspective, this net here, it's about 2 kilometers around. That would take me about 10 minutes to run around it. It's that big. And these fishing vessels are the ones that are your dolphin-friendly tuna. So their purpose is to fish for tuna. And in West Africa, there's about 60 of these operating at any one time. And they are taking millions of tons of tuna. But the problem that they also have is, when you set a net like that, you have no idea that it's just tuna in that net. So that's 2 kilometers wide. It's also around, and it's also 200 meters deep. So just imagine how many animals are trapped in that net right now. They can be, you know, I've seen whales, and actual whales in there, the really big whales I've seen in these nets. We've actually cut whale sharks out of these nets before, you know, the largest fish in the ocean. They can grow up to about 20 meters. They're caught in these nets. Manta rays are caught in these nets. Tuna are obviously caught in these nets. Turtles are caught in these nets. And the problem that they have is nobody's reporting on this. So we've got no idea how many animals have been caught in these nets. And the way they work them, so once they set, they're called a purse seine, and they basically like string it together at the bottom. So it purse like a purse when it shuts. And then they drag it all in. So when they start to drag it all in, that's what it looks like. The fish get closer and closer to the boat. They pull the net up, the fish start coming on. And bear in mind, this is tuna that they're fishing for the most part, yellowfin tuna. And, you know, a good size yellowfin tuna is about 60 kilos. And it's like me, basically. It's the same height as me, probably the same weight as me. That's a good size yellow tuna, so that's what they're targeting in here. But that's not what they're getting. You can, it's really hard. Normally, I don't know if this has got a pointer. So, shark, I can't see, it's blurry. All these here are sharks. Those sharks are not going to survive that. Bear in mind the weight of this crushing down on those sharks. They chuck them back, yes they do, but they're already dead at that point. So it's just one of these things where you can't say that this is friendly to any kind of marine animal because it is not. Anything that ends up in that net is going to die eventually, whether it's because of being caught because they want that fish, whether it's being caught because you accidentally were there, the stress of it is eventually going to end up killing you even if you escape it. So what happens when they pull that in? They bring the sharks up. And these are not, they're not fishing these for their fins. It's nothing about fins. All these vessels are actually licensed to either Spain or France. This is EU fishing. And it's all happening in West Africa, purely because that's where all the fish are. There's about 40% of Atlantic tunas caught in Gabon alone. So the rest of it is caught up and down the countries of West Africa. And it's for Europeans. So I know that like a lot of people like to blame Asia, but we're all equally guilty of destroying our oceans. And when they haul them up, they put them over the side and they drop them in the water one by one. And the stress of it, you can see, it's already regurgitated his stomach up. It was the most horrific thing I've ever seen in my life. And I was sat in the boat that took that picture. And, you know, I've seen a lot of really horrible things at sea. This is by far the worst thing that I have ever experienced. And it was purely just because there were so many of them. This particular boat, on that one net, we counted 117 sharks in one net, and they do about 4 or 5 a day, depending how good the fishing is and if they're staying in the area. So 117 sharks in one net. They reported 4 for the entire day. So this isn't illegal fishing, bear in mind. This is all licensed. It's all above board. It's unreported. We've got no idea that they're taking this many sharks. Endangered skeleton hammerhead sharks, too. It's a big deal, and nobody knows about this. So, I've just done my 5 minutes, so I'm going to move on quickly now. But this is a bit of a different boat. This is a long line. It's a Spanish fishing vessel targeting sharks. It was supposed to be targeting tuna and similar species. Sharks are not similar species to tuna. The only similarities, I guess, is that they swim in the ocean. So they were targeting them for the fins. This is completely legal as well. This is not illegal fishing here. They were all fins, and this is, it blew my mind how many sharks would have been in this boat. And the only reason that we were able to arrest this vessel in the end was because they were breaking the EU recommendation that fins need to be naturally attached to the sharks when they're caught. So they're supposed to land all of these sharks' carcasses, not just their fins, but they were chucking them up. They were chucking the bits back that they didn't want. And the way that we knew that they were specifically targeting sharks is it's got this metal trace in its mouth. So if that's in the water, it's going to like sparkle and all the fish are going to swim away. And that's what, you know, sharks are badasses, right? So they're the ones that are like, well, doesn't scare me. But not only are we wiping out that generation, we're wiping out the next generation and the next generation and the next generation. So we found like tiny little sharks on there as well, like, they don't even have fins big enough. They just chuck these back in the water. So we arrested that vessel, took it back to São Tomé, And it was just slapped with a minimum fine and off it goes again fishing. All because we want tuna. A lot of these boats are doing this. But this specifically was for shark fins. That was the anomaly on the campaign. So the way that we kind of do these inspections, we are, obviously we have the armed guards with us. We have the Marine National on Gabon. We have the Coast Guard in Liberia where we've been working. And we have fisheries observers and we have the Sea Shepherd crew. So this is me. I actually led the inspection teams for a lot of the boardings that we did, my little pink camera. And part of my job for this was basically to check all the paperwork and do a lot of box ticking. So I would spend hours on the bridge with the captains. We would go over all the documentation. I would try my damn hardest to try and get something where we could arrest them for not having paperwork, because it's so much easier than when we find things like shark fins on board. They had about five of these. You can't arrest a boat for having five shark fins on board. Sometimes there were monkeys on board. And we arrested this boat purely because the monkey didn't have a passport. It was the only way we were managing to get this boat to like go back to port, because he said, you know, you've taken this monkey from another country in West Africa and you've brought it to Liberia. So it was the only reason we were able to arrest that vessel. On other boats, you see complete devastation. This is all bycatch. This is not the target catch here. So this is either being, you know, kept on board to give to the local communities, or basically for the crew to eat, or a lot of it, for the most part, we'd see was spread in the water after they left. They chuck it back overboard once it had been sorted. But the one thing that we did find on every single vessel was dead sharks, another scallop hammerhead, endangered species. We would see dead sharks with dead fish in their mouth. And this, like, it's horrendous. But there is something that we can do about this. This is my friend, Mo. He was amazing. And he is one of the Liberian Marine National, is the like Gabon equivalent. They're basically like the police of the sea. And, you know, they actually want to make these changes. And that's what's really great with working in partnership with African governments. They want to make changes. And Sea Shepherd is giving them now the facility to be able to go police their waters and make these arrests. The only thing that we need to start changing is the law, so we can actually hold them accountable for what they're doing. So it's not all doom and gloom. I'm going to wrap up now. And I just want to say, you know, that in working in partnership with people, we're making changes. And being able to come to events like this and talk about what we're doing, we're able to make changes. Changing what's on your menu is going to have a big impact. Stop eating fish. Just because you don't eat sharks doesn't mean you're not killing sharks. You are. If you eat fish, you're responsible for the decline of our oceans. And other than that, plastic. Plastic's the big thing. Stop using single-use plastic. Make these small changes, and we can have a huge difference. Thank you.